A new pharaoh arises, and he doesn't remember Joseph. He enslaves the people because they're becoming too numerous and becoming a threat. So he puts them to work and embitters their lives, building store cities of Pithom and Ramses, and makes them create bricks out of mud and straw.
It was intriguing to see this type of construction in different parts of Egypt. Were any of these bricks molded by the hands of Israelite slaves? However, Mansour was quick to remind me that these types of mud bricks are present throughout Egypt's history and don't prove any connection to the Israelites. In his search for evidence that fits the idea of Israelite slavery, Professor James Hoffmeyer focuses on the first half of the New Kingdom because he favors a Ramesses Exodus date. There he finds a very interesting set of evidence.
It states in the biblical story that the Hebrews were supposed to make bricks from mud and straw. Is there any evidence of that?
We have two lines of evidence that this practice referred to in Exodus chapter 1 and Exodus chapter 5 really was the sort of thing going on. We have the depiction in the tomb of Rechmire. He was a vizier or prime minister under Thutmose III in the 15th century. And there we can see POWs, both Semites from Canaan and Syria, working alongside prisoners of war from Nubia, black Africans. And there they are making bricks, overseen by Egyptian taskmasters with sticks. And so it's very clear that this was the treatment of prisoners of war. And we see these foreigners making bricks in southern Egypt for a building project at Karnak Temple. And I'm sure that picture could be replicated to other parts of Egypt, especially in the north. Secondly, we also have, from the same time period, the 15th century, the 18th dynasty, we also have pictures of agricultural work, especially work in the vineyards, picking grapes, stomping on grapes to make juice and wine. Here again, we find the same prisoners of war engaged in agriculture. Exodus 1:14 actually says they worked in brick and mortar and agriculture. So interestingly, the very two areas the Bible says the Israelites were forced to work in, agriculture and construction work, is the very two places we see this sort of work going on in private tombs in Egypt in the 15th century BC.
Now, were all these prisoners of war, could these have been people such as the Bible states that were actually there that became suspicious and then were forced into labor?
In the case of the tomb of Rechmire, tomb 100 in the Theban necropolis, it actually tells us they were hawk, they were plundered, they were prisoners brought back from the king's campaigns. Mm-hmm. So, and these happen to be in the south in Luxor. The problem is we don't have corresponding tombs for what was going on in the Delta, which where the Hebrews were, so we lack that kind of evidence. Also during the 15th century BC, we have the beginnings of the deportations of prisoners of war from the wars of the pharaohs Thutmose I, Thutmose III, Amenhotep II. These are bringing prisoners of war both from Syria and Canaan, as well as from Nubia to the south. All these prisoners of war are flooding into Egypt and are being pressed into hard labor for the state. So we have both the old Semitic population, second, third generation of whom are still around in the 15th, 14th, 13th century, and then you have the new population of Semites who were brought in as POWs from the campaigns of the Egyptian pharaohs. So there was a significant network of foreign people living in Egypt during the New Kingdom.
While this is good evidence for the presence of Semitic slaves doing the right types of work, prisoners of war do not match the Bible's account of the early Israelites. Meanwhile, David Rowe pointed to a different set of evidence that fits the pattern found in Egypt's Middle Kingdom, beginning with finds from Avaris.
Well, what happened next? What does the archaeological record show?
What we then see is that the graves of these people, we begin to see in the bones deterioration in the quality of life. We see Harris lines in the bones, which indicate famine, shortage of food and nutrients. These people suddenly have become impoverished. Not only that, but we start to see larger houses, which seem to be Egyptian in design, and then smaller houses attached to them, which seem to be servants' houses. And this is what we see for the very first time. And we even find papyri with lists of slaves with Semitic names on them at this period as well.
Tell me more about the bones.
If we look at the cemetery population, that's the dead, if you like, and that's the evidence we have of the living, is the dead. And we look at their graves, we find something very interesting happens. At the beginning, these people seem to prosper. The quality of their lives is very good. But all of a sudden, at some point in the story, we see a degeneration. We see a degeneration in the burials and the actual graves themselves. The investigation of the anthropological data has shown us that we are dealing with people who lived probably to about 32 to 34 years of age and then died. That's the typical life expectancy of the time. So we're not talking about a people who prospered and went on to live into their 50s and 60s, as you might expect. These people had really tough lives. So how do we explain that? What is the mechanism that we would understand why these people only lived to such a short age? And the obvious answer is slavery.
So you're saying that this group that came in that was prosperous then fell on hard times?
Yeah. We've got a situation of prosperity followed by a lack of prosperity and a shortage of life. So it seems very clear that these Asiatic peoples, these people have come from the north, speaking a Semitic language, who first of all prospered in this region, have suddenly been enslaved.
Is there any physical evidence that there was slavery of Hebrew-type people in Egypt?
There's one particular document which is quite amazing. It's called the Brooklyn Papyrus. And this actually is a list of domestic servants from one estate. We have maybe up to 100 people listed as slaves in Egypt. When we look at those names, 70% of them are Semitic names. And you can literally pick off Israelite names in there. Menachem, Issachar, and Asher, the names of two of the tribes of Israel. Shifra, one of the Hebrew midwives in the Exodus story, a name that appears in this document. These are Hebrew Israelite slaves, and they're in a papyrus from the 13th dynasty, not from the 19th dynasty, not from the time of Ramesses II in the New Kingdom, but from the 13th dynasty, the Middle Kingdom.
What does this mean to you? What does it say?
This is real evidence for the time when the Israelites were in Egypt as slaves. It's when you get a text, suddenly you've got history. Archaeology, you have to interpret. When you have a text, this is something very different.
David, can you put a specific date on the Brooklyn Papyrus?
The Brooklyn Papyrus is dated to one reign. The name of the king appears on it, and it's called, and the king is called Sobekhotep III. Now, he's the first king of a mini-dynasty in the 13th dynasty, where you have maybe four or five very powerful rulers coming to the fore, a family of strong pharaohs. And this could be the pharaoh who did not know Joseph, the one who enslaved the Israelites, because it comes maybe three or four generations after the Middle Kingdom, when Joseph arrives in Egypt, we suddenly find this strong pharaoh, Sobekhotep III, and we have this list of slaves with Israelite names.
David, the thing that I'm puzzled by is why so many Egyptologists ignore the Brooklyn Papyrus.
Well, this is the old problem again about time, isn't it? You have a situation here where, although everybody recognizes that this list is a list of Semitic slaves, and everybody recognizes that the names appearing in here are also Israelite names, these can't be the Israelites, because it's the wrong time period. The Israelites are much later in history. So these people we're seeing here in this Brooklyn Papyrus in the time of Sobekhotep III cannot be the Israelites. All this evidence that we're finding in Avaris, this city in Goshen in the Eastern Delta, points us to the period when the Israelites were in Egypt, and that is the period we call the Middle Bronze Age. Most Egyptologists put the period of the slavery in the New Kingdom, in the 19th dynasty, and here we are in the 13th dynasty, so the things don't match.
So that's why they disregard it.
So they put it to one side and say it's another coincidence.
All right, Shalawan, Shalawan, Shalawan. I want to give all praises to our Heavenly Father, Yahweh, who's only begotten Son, Yahweh Shah, man. Hey, I want to bring out some quick history. History can't back out, man. gonna bring out some basic history on how the proof of the Hebrews in Egypt, man. Right, so this is gonna be for edification, not for debate, not for none of that. This is for you people, especially our people, who wanna know what's going on in the world and know our history. Not what they taught us in school, not what your mama taught you, not what your pastor taught you, okay? Not what your damn friend taught you, man. What the scriptures and what history actually says, bro. Right? Because one thing about it, you know, lies will not stand, man. So let's get into it. The Apur Papyrus. The Apur Papyrus is an ancient Egyptian hieratic papyrus made during the 19th dynasty of Egypt and now held in the Dutch National Museum of Antiquities in Leiden, Netherlands. It contains the admonitions of Apur, right, an incomplete literary work whose original composition is dated no earlier than the late 12th dynasty of Egypt. So this is from 1991 BCE through 1803. So this was about 2,000 years before Yahweh Shai, the Messiah, came on the scene. And I'm gonna show y'all something, man. So the Apur Papyrus, when you translate it, right? So when you translate it, hold on, my bad. But look, what you see on the screen, bro, what you see on the bottom screen is a, hold on, I wish I could zoom it in, bro. What y'all see on the bottom screen, that's the Hebrews coming out of Egypt, man. With the, I believe that's the death angel flying over, right? And as you can clearly see, it's the Egyptians, right? The other dark race in the river, man. Right? That's why in Exodus 11 and 7, for those of you who believe in the Heavenly Father, those of you who have chosen to seek the truth, right? Archaeology and history helps a lot, man. A lot of y'all beloveds that's new to my channel, I'm not gonna get into it. I'm about to get into the lesson. A lot of y'all beloveds that's new to this channel. On my old FTW channel, the very first one I had a lot of history on there. As some of you can see, I have the history of the Israelites that were in Europe, Constantine and Shakespeare, Mozart, are these men and women who were Israelites, man. And so let's get into it. The Apur Papyrus, right? So anytime an Egyptologist or a Hotep guy try to argue with you, their own idols, who are these Egyptians, they will cut them. So Apur said, there is blood everywhere. Lo, the river is blood. The scriptures say in Exodus 7 and 20, all the waters that were in the river returned to blood, right? It says one thirst for water, Exodus 7 and 24. So the Egyptians dug all around the river for water to drink because they could not drink the water of the river, okay? So these are the Hamites at this time. So it says, lo, trees are filled or filled, branches are stripped, Exodus 9:25, and the hail broke every tree of the field, right? Lo, grain is lacking on all sides, Exodus 9:31. Now the flax and the barley were struck. See that? He also said, birds find neither fruit nor herbs, Exodus 10:15. They, locusts, ate every herb of the land, right? And all the fruit of the trees which the hail had left, man. So the Heavenly Father, right, put it on the spirit of this Egyptian to write this down, man. Because he already knew you're going to have scoffers in the last days. Because these people are so carnal and they're so indoctrinated with their lies, man. That they don't have a desire. They don't have a drive to search out the history of their people, man. Right? Our people love money. They love cars. They love smashing whores. They love white Jesus. They love Muhammad. They love everything else outside of the truth, man. It actually grieves them. They don't have that zeal. So groaning is throughout the land, mingled with laments. Exodus 12 and 30. And there was a great cry in Egypt. It says, lo, many dead are buried in the river. The stream is the grave. The tomb became stream, man. It was a lot of dead bodies. And he who puts his brother in the ground is everywhere. Exodus 33 and 4. For the Egyptians were burying all their firstborn, man. Right? So for all you people, the Heavenly Father, that's just your belief. That's what you believe in. No, bro. Y'all don't believe in the living God, man. That's why you are ever learning and never coming to the truth. That's why you have, that's why our people, you were in the curses, man. That is y'all fault. All is ruined. Egypt is destroyed. And that's Exodus 10 and 7, man. You see that? So I'm going to actually download the actual evidence, man. Because you got people talking about, well, how there's no proof of. No, bro. You just hate God, bro. Like, you just hate God, bro. Hold on. Now, for all you people, man. Now, archaeologists, right? They went in the Red Sea, man. Right? And they found chariot wheels at the bottom of the Red Sea, man. But though this evidence is presented unto you, you don't believe because you're carnal. There's no money in it. See that? So the same chariot wheels, the same archaeological evidence you see here, bro. Right? They're not going to teach you this in school, dude. See? So you can't say, well, there's no evidence. There's no evidence. Nah, bro. The people just scoff, man. So this is how they try to whitewash the images, right? I want y'all to see something, bro. Look at the difference between the actual history, right? They were all brown, or so-called black, and look what they created. This is why a lot of people are confused, man, because you don't study history. You study, especially you niggas, bro. You look at the image. You don't think to look past the image, okay? None of these people look like this, bro. That's called iconoclasm. Matter of fact, let's get that real quick. Right? Yeah, I know how to. Let's see. So, Alistair Cromwell, right? Who's a goddamn Mason? All right, let me show y'all something, bro. Hold on. Y'all give me a second. Hold on. All right. Anyways, back to the point, man. Phone tried to go crazy on me, man. Now, let me see. How do you go to the original page of this thing? I'm just typing in Cromwell. Look at this, mo. See? Hold on. So I'm trying to get, let's see. Uh, Right, because they love to hide information, bro. Was it this one? Nope, that wasn't it. Thieves. Let me see. Got Jacobites. Y'all look at this, bro. See that? So swarthy means brown, bro. Okay. I'm bringing this out because they love to whitewash every damn thing, man. But I'm looking up a specific individual, man. Hold on real quick. I want y'all to notice how they always try to hide information, bro. That proves how much of a devil y'all are and how jealous y'all are, man. Meghan Markle, whatever the fuck her name. Bro, she's not the first. She's not the first. First of all, she's not even our people. She's an Edomite, I think. But, why I can't find this damn thing, bro? See how they do this shit? Hold on. All right, but when you see the Russian icons, you clearly see, all right, people of color, man. Like, give me a second, man. All right, I think I found a website. It says, whites claim that the statues are all of so-called mythical. Bro, see, you Romans, you Idumeans, bro. Y'all motherfuckers love steal people's culture and call it a myth, bro. Sit the fuck down, goddammit. Bro, nobody wanna be y'all, bro. But then, for all you racist honkies, bro, that's not talking about y'all, bro. Damn, y'all a cunt, bro. Man, look. And it is being blocked, bro. You can barely find the damn website. Let me see. See? This is King Jehu of Yasharala, Israel. Leads a procession bringing tribute to Assyrian King Shalmaneser, bro. It's talking about my forefathers, man. It's not talking about yours. You want to be everybody else but yourself. Y'all want to come up with some damn evolution, bro. And this is not the real... That's Caesar Borgia, bro. That's not the Messiah, bro. You niggas can't get past that. And watch this. Charles V, or Spanish Carlos V, was Holy Roman Emperor and Archduke of Austria from 1519 through 1556. King of Spain, Castile, and Aragon from 1516 through 1556. And Lord of the Netherlands as titular Duke of Burgundy from 1506 through 1555, bro. These are clearly dark-skinned. These are Incas. A panel from the painting in the Large Gold Museum in Lima, Peru, depicting the Inca emperors. See that? All dark-skinned, bro. They don't look like you motherfuckers. See? Let me see, man. Black Britain, there we go. Hopefully this is it. Is it it? Cause I gotta get Alistair Cromwell, man. Cause y'all niggas love to hide shit, bro. They love to hide stuff, bro. That's the Georgia Guidestones. But, actually, no, this wasn't the page I was looking for. Damn, this dude got a lot of information on here. See, Black Mediterranean and coin pottery, man. These are our people, dude. The ancient Antelonians. A lot of these people are... Look at them big-ass lips, man. See that? Like, this stuff is Googleable, man. You Jakes just don't like to know nothing, bro. But that's y'all fault. I'd rather know about my heritage and my people. We weren't just slaves, bro, and they did not take millions. Yo, you dudes, you natural Israelites, man. You just let them lie to you, man. That's your fault. Fools hate knowledge, bro. Go be a dummy over there and complain about your oppressor all day. Go be stupid. That is stupid, bro. I'm sorry. Damn. Hold on. But yeah, man, it was a guy named Alistair Cromwell, bro. He basically was responsible for 97%. He was responsible for 97% of the whitewashing of the images, bro. But I brought all this history out. Is that Nebuchadnezzar? Or Persian soldier Xerxes, man. See that? But yeah, he was responsible for 97% of the whitewashed images. And it's crazy how I can't find this guy. Alright, you see that? So this is during the 8th century, bro. You people are not the people of the book, bro. So shut the hell up. Get mad at Kyrie and get mad at Kanye. Kanye's not even... Bro, I told y'all Kanye is not for real, bro. It said these people with no connection to ancient Yasharala moved up into Eastern and Western Europe and then headed for the U.S. and Israel to become today's grape drink population, bro. Y'all are not the Israelites, as you can clearly see. These are not your people, bro. Sit down, bro. Damn, it's so easy to disprove this shit, and you still got niggas, bro. And all you Negroes and all you people who refute knowledge, bro. In the end, bro, like, y'all are gonna... That's gonna be y'all downfall, man. Thieves. Anyways, man. With that being said, peace and blessings and shalom.